nice to see so many folks back. The slide that I showed with the pump handle, I thought that I'd put that on there. That's a bit complicated, but it is basically contains the take-home lesson from all of this, which is that carbon dioxide is going up, and it's higher now than it's been for at least 800,000 years. I want to mention a couple of points from the last lecture. What I tried to do was tell you how it is that we know that carbon dioxide is rising, and how it is that we know that it's carbon dioxide that's causing the changes in the climate. And also, how it is that we know that it's us that are putting this, is putting the CO2 up there. And as regards that, the answer is it has everything to do with the plants from a long, long time ago. When plants take up carbon dioxide, they discriminate against one of the stable isotopes of carbon dioxide, carbon-13. It's a little heavier than most of the carbon in carbon dioxide. It's about 8% heavier. But because it's heavier, it doesn't diffuse into the leaf as fast as the light stuff does. That's just because heavy things don't move as quickly as light stuff does. So plants, when they do photosynthesis, have a fingerprint on them. And that fingerprint goes with them when they die and turn into fossil fuel. And when we burn the fossil fuel, the carbon that comes back to the atmosphere is depleted in that heavy isotope. We have seen the dilution of the heavy isotope with time. That was one of Keeling's major contributions. And that is the fingerprint of us on rising carbon dioxide. Now, about how we know that it's CO2 that's doing the warming, it was one of the animations that I showed, where it showed that all the changes we could expect to have some effect on the climate, that is, they've got to be big enough to do something with the climate, and it might be volcanoes, it might be changes in land use, it might be the sun, and that figure showed that none of those since 1750 have changed enough to account for the effects that we see on temperature in the atmosphere, but carbon dioxide has, and that's the evidence that it's carbon dioxide that's causing the warming. Now, there was one more piece of evidence I didn't present, but I'd like to mention it. There's another kind of evidence that the atmosphere is warming and that's caused by carbon dioxide, and that is when you look at the atmospheric structure itself, it's gotten thicker. And it would only do that if you added something to it. Not only that, but that part that's getting thicker is the part that warms up. The whole atmosphere is not warmed by the sun. The atmosphere is warmed only by the infrared coming from the Earth, and that's mostly lower down. So that thickening of the atmosphere is often quoted as the third way that we can look to carbon dioxide as the source, and we as the source of the carbon dioxide. Now, what I would like to do today is move on to the effects of warming, because the big take-home lesson from all of this is that we produce carbon dioxide, which increases in the atmosphere, and it's the carbon dioxide that causes the warming. So global warming results in climate change. So the physical process is more CO2 makes the atmosphere warmer, and that heat then disperses first into the ocean and everywhere else on the land. It tends to warm the land quicker than the ocean because the ocean is such a big mass, but about 90% of the heat from the atmosphere actually goes into the ocean. The ocean is like a colossal flywheel, and when we begin to heat it up, it will be very difficult to slow it down. That's why it's critical we get serious about doing something about climate change. And today's lecture is going to focus on warming, sea level rise, and extreme weather. So the first slide deals with the first button, an animation, which shows you the temperature distribution over the Earth as measured since 1750. Now, since 1750, we have ways of measuring the temperature of the Earth, namely with thermometers. But thermometry really came along in the 1800s. So you'll see back here on this little scale is a temperature scale, and this is the plus or minus 1 degree centigrade from some average. Average is taken to be here. All right, so now we push the button. Whoops, wrong button. Okay, here we go. And it should begin. Ta-da, there we go. Follow the little red ball. And the little red ball tells you what year it is up there, the number of stations and decades on the left, the land covered up here on the right, and this scale here is the temperature deviation from zero, and zero is that arbitrary normalized number that is about right here, to tell you whether or not it's getting warmer or colder. And you can see that as far as the 19th century was concerned, it was much colder than it is now. In fact, during the Revolutionary War, the temperature of Roanoke was approximately the same as the winter temperature of Toronto, Canada. Things have warmed quite a bit since then. So this is showing you the temperature distribution now. By 1900, we were measuring temperatures all over the world. In fact, by the middle of the 19th century, everybody was measuring temperatures, and it was a kind of a cottage industry to record your temperatures and then share it with everybody. Okay, so now we hit about 1980, and here goes the temperature up quite dramatically. So, and as you know, 2016 was the warmest year on record. Here is the mean temperature departure from average for December 2015 to February 2016. It was an extremely warm winter. Here's the scale down here, and this is Fahrenheit. This unfortunately goes back and forth between centigrade and Fahrenheit. And so you can see the central part of the country was extremely warm. So was Maine. A couple of winters ago, Maine was like other places. We were getting lots of snow and it was getting cold. And they set a low temperature record of 50 below in March, showing you that the temperature, while it's changing globe-wise, it's not the same everywhere and it's not changing the same everywhere. It's changing more rapidly over the land, more rapidly in the north, and more rapidly at night. When I first gave a talk like this in my hometown a number of years ago, one of the people I'd grown up with afterwards came up to see me and he said, "Well, I enjoyed all this, but let me see if I got the message. You say it's warming up mostly in the north, mostly in the winter, and mostly at night. Is there really a problem here?" In northern Maine, we used to say we have 9 months of winter and 3 months of poor sledding. All right, here's an animation of the temperature increase since 1881. This is the whole year, and each one is represented by a different color, obviously, as it gets warmer and warmer. So there's 2016. 2016 was definitely the warmest of all, but before that, the warmest was 2015, and before that,
2014.
I have a cheering section down front, and can't contain themselves sometimes. Okay, 2016, the hottest year on record. Temperature in Baghdad at the international airport hit 109 or higher nearly every day since June 19th. This is from the Washington Post in August. Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, all-time high of nearly 126 degrees, Basra 129. The heat index, you all know what the heat index is. It combines humidity and temperature. Relatively dry place, but the heat index had hit 140 over the United Arab Emirates. And this led folks at the Washington Post in October to claim that the Persian Gulf may be too hot for human survival by 2090, particularly if the current political situation continues. The Arctic is warming faster than the rest of the globe. This is a very interesting phenomenon, and things are happening in the Arctic more quickly than anywhere else. And we're going to look at the reason for that. First of all, though, here is an interesting animation put out by NASA. It's 2016, and it started up there in April. And it's showing the decline in snow throughout. Snow covers a third of the globe in the wintertime. Here it is at the end of August, and you can see the retreat of all the ice, and then it begins to reappear again. And I think I'll show you that one more time because that was relatively brief. Watch the snow disappear because the next big take-home lesson has to do with something called albedo. Albedo is derived from Latin albia, which means white. The cliffs of Dover prompted the Romans to name the island Albion because of the white cliffs. Okay, so the ice disappears because of the warming. And this year, 2016, as far as we got to September, was not quite the record year 2012 was. But the point is the sea ice is going away in the Arctic. And now that has considerable significance for the rest of the globe. The Arctic is kind of the air conditioner for North America and for Russia. And when the ice goes away, then it opens the water. And the water absorbs solar energy to a much, much greater extent than does the ice. And here is the poster child for all of this. This is one of the most pathetic pictures. I doubt that the polar bear will ever become extinct. I don't think that we are capable of seeing what we call charismatic megafauna. Thank you. Those big words are too much for me. Charismatic megafauna typically don't go extinct, but lots of other things that we don't pay much attention to, like plants or things that live in the ocean that we can't see, are likely to. Okay, albedo, up here on the left, snow and ice covered water. When the ice is there, 90% is reflected and only 10% goes into the ice. That's enough for some algae though, because there are lots of algae that live under the ice. So when the ice goes away, 94% of it is the solar radiation is absorbed. And you can see then that here in the Arctic, where there's lots of water and lots of land, there is every reason to think that it could get warmer if the ice goes away. So the question comes up, why is all the sea ice leaving the Arctic but not the Antarctic? And the answer is that the Arctic is surrounded by land. And it's the land that's absorbing the heat from the sun faster than the water, having a larger effect on the air. And as the land warms up, it transfers heat back to the atmosphere. And so the Arctic is warming much faster than the Antarctic, which is simply surrounded by water. So the next time you're in an elevator with lots of folks and somebody says, I wonder why the Antarctic is not... You got it. The other big thing up in the north that's melting quickly is Greenland. And Greenland is melting really quite rapidly. I don't know, if you read The New Yorker, you'll remember from last summer, there was an article by Elizabeth Colbert, who writes about climate change a lot, and she wrote something called Letter from Greenland. What she tends to do is take a field trip. I mean, her field trips are like, you really wish that you could take all the money you have and go on one with her, because she goes all over the place, and she's a good writer. So she went to Greenland, and she connected up with people who were on Greenland studying the ice melt, and she writes this very personal, but very down to ice story about what's going on there. And Greenland is melting really rapidly, by any measure that we have. So the question becomes, how long do we have? How long will it take Greenland to melt? The estimate that I saw recently was that if you take the fastest rate of melting on Greenland and try to estimate how long it would take all that ice to melt, it's about 7,000 years. So it isn't going to melt immediately. It will melt in many hundreds, if not thousands of years. If you multiply that fast rate by 10, it will still take over 700 years to melt Greenland. So at least from this perspective, the answer to the question, when will Greenland melt? And the first time I mentioned it, I didn't know the answer. not right away. But there is so much ice on Greenland and in Antarctica that as it starts to melt, it will have an effect on sea level. And we know that it is already. If all the ice in Greenland were to melt, the sea level would come up about 20 feet. If all of the ice in Antarctica melts, it will come up about 200 feet. So if all the ice and ice caps leave, we will too, because we can't be here. It will have an enormous effect on the way people can live on Earth. So the answer to the question, does climate change threaten our way of life? It surely does. We can see it, but we can see it at a distance. Another measure of how warming is affecting things on Earth is the declining snow cover. The picture on the left shows the snow cover in June in 1967, and on the right in 2012. Down here is the scale. So it's pretty obvious that the snow is going away much more quickly. And as it does, of course, the albedo changes, and this accelerates the warming. Here is the data from 1967 until now, and it shows that in that period of time, about 40 years, the snow cover in June over the Earth has declined by at least 50%, and is going down rapidly. Mountain glaciers are being eroded and melting very quickly. Over here is a picture of this big glacier, the Rhone Glacier in Switzerland. It has shrunk dramatically since 1850. Here's 1850, and over there it's all rock. The ice goes away. And here is from the United States, Boulder Glacier in Montana Glacier National Park. I think Glacier National Park should have a question mark beside it, because it won't be long until there will be no glaciers in Glacier National Park. So if you have any interest in seeing one, it might not be a bad plan to go have a look. If you're serious about bucket lists, seeing a real glacier might be one thing to put on it. But we could ask why matter. Worldwide, they're very important because for periods of time when drinking water is in short supply, say in India, and other parts of Asia, mountain glaciers provide the only water available. So one thing is drinking water for hundreds of millions of people. Another is irrigation for crops and water for animals during drought. And electric power. Dams are built on glacial streams. In a country like Norway, electricity is extraordinarily cheap. But it's all dependent on rivers draining these large snow masses at higher altitude. Here is a figure from the Scientific and Technical Working Group in Maryland Climate Change. In the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about stuff happening only here and on the Chesapeake Bay. And here's the first one. This working group completed its stuff a couple of years ago, and it relied a great deal on this report from the National Research Council. And here's a good place to mention, if you're curious about this stuff, where do you go for information? And the answer is many, many places. The National Academy of Sciences is a good place to start. They write reports that are accessible, they're free, and they are written in a way that taxpayers can understand what they're saying. In fact, they went out of their way with the Royal Society of Great Britain to write a report a couple of years ago, and that one would be an excellent one to have a look at, because they cover the field broadly, and they talk about all the stuff that I'm talking about here, and I take some of the figures that I've got from such places. And in Maryland, they did the same thing. The Climate Change Commission made an effort to communicate to everybody that sea level rise is really something that we have to pay attention to. And the reason is, we live beside a huge puddle that's really shallow. And when water comes into, when any extra water comes into it, it doesn't have any place to go, like up, as it does in Maine. I mean, you can stand on the main coast of Maine and look clear down to where the water probably will be in the next century, because the cliffs are so high. And Maryland, it's so flat that whenever a storm comes or whenever the sea level comes up, the water just spreads out. So it has a relatively bigger effect here. In fact, sea level is coming up faster here on the East Coast than any other place in the country, except maybe in Louisiana. So here are the places on Earth where people's lives are immediately threatened by rising sea level. There's about 50 large river deltas in the world where rising sea level is posing a serious problem for people. The risk and sustainability of coastal deltas was reported on recently by a paper in Science magazine. But there is a lot of information about this, and if you Google river deltas and rising sea level, you'll be overwhelmed with the amount of information. The important thing is that the amount of people that live in these river deltas is really big. There's the population in these deltas is equal at least to the population of the United States, the population that's threatened. Generally, there are people who can't afford to be there, can't afford to leave. And generally, their farms are there. For example, there's an awful lot of rice growing right at sea level, and that is being decimated by rising sea level because salt comes in with the seawater, and rice doesn't handle salt very well. So sea level is rising quickly, and it's having a major effect on lots of people around the world. There will be small islands that will be disappearing that are right at sea level. So sea level rise is a major risk. This one shows some poor, unfortunate person, probably the wife or girlfriend of a photographer, who decided he had to have a picture of Venice flooded with water. You wouldn't think that a flood in Venice would be such a big deal, but it is, and Venice is, of course, struggling with it. It's that they have been exposed to this the whole time, and they have a pretty good idea of what the risks are and probably how to handle it. When I first began doing this kind of work, for some reason I made contact with people in the Netherlands. I was invited to come and tell them about the research that we were doing, and my big question was, what are you guys doing about this? And they're very blasé about it, because rising sea level is job security for the thousands and thousands of hydraulic engineers that they've produced over all the years. Now they have more work to do. What they seem to do really well is pile stuff up at the edge of the water to keep water from coming in. I don't want to make light of it, but they have understood what it means to have the sea as an enemy. And so far, they've been winning. And they one of the things they're doing is exporting their knowledge and expertise to other places. For example, to New York City. because after Hurricane Sandy, New York City discovered it had a major problem, and people from the Netherlands have been consulting with them. So I didn't read what's at the top, but it says that basically flooding is putting lots and lots of people out of their homes. Now, right here at home in Annapolis, here is a figure from the Climate Central organization that has been reporting us. The place to go for stuff about sea level rise is the Union of Concerned Scientists. They have a number of publications and a number of really interesting figures that show the impacts of sea level and rising sea level. And so here they show it by basically decade, and very clearly the number of flooding days, coastal flooding, since about 1955 has shot up dramatically. In the decade that we're in right now, the number of days of flooding in the city is up to almost one a year. Now, I don't know exactly where they put the marker for flooding, but they do, and they say that the dominant feature is human, not natural. The same thing for Washington, D.C. All the cities on the east coast of the United States are threatened by coastal flooding. They call it nuisance flooding in the report that they published, and it is a colossal nuisance. It's a terrible nuisance for old, low-lying communities whose sewer systems and water systems didn't anticipate anything like what's happening now. Although in the Chesapeake Bay, islands have been eroding basically since John Smith was here, but not at the rate it's happening now, and it will be a shame to lose some of the low-lying communities that are famous, like Smith Island, for example. The report on sea level rise that I mentioned a couple of slides ago estimates that there will be a loss of more than 300,000 acres of agricultural land in Maryland from sea level rise. That's a huge economic impact on this state. Here's just another figure showing Annapolis. It was from the report that I mentioned, and it mentions the number of days when the flooding came up onto the city dock. So it's a fairly common affair. And now these next couple of figures are from the Union of Concerned Scientists. Here is sea level in 1880. Between 1880 and now, 130 years, sea level has come up 8 inches. But now, between now and this level here is the low end of the range, and this level here is the high end of the range for sea level rising by 2050. The reason that a range is put in there is because so many factors are involved that it's very hard to make an exact estimate of how much the sea level is going to come up. So they put a range on it. And the mean is somewhere in here, but this poor child is almost out of breathing room. And then by the year 2100, everybody is underwater. The expected sea level could come up as much as 6 feet. This is an enormous amount in a very short time. The largest hurricane in the Atlantic in recent times was Superstorm Sandy. It actually was a hurricane of level 3 when it was in the Caribbean. It did an enormous amount of damage in the Caribbean. Many tens of people were killed. For the whole history of the storm, 233 people killed. But hurricanes are not the major killers connected with climate change. That's heat. What they really do is they destroy property. Now, there's an interesting connection with this destruction of property and hurricanes in that it appears that with time, more and more people are moving into threatened areas. It doesn't appear that the number of hurricanes has increased significantly, although the intensity of the largest ones has increased. And that's because the high end of hurricanes In fact, the whole intensity of hurricanes is coupled to the temperature of the sea at the surface. So as sea surface temperature goes up, the intensity of hurricanes goes up. I mentioned last lecture that the energy for all of this comes from evaporation and then condensation of water vapor. That provides an enormous amount of energy and feeds hurricanes. So Hurricane Sandy was one of these. It caused an enormous amount of damage. Here is a picture from the time. This is in New York City, probably Wall Street. And you can tell it's New York City because it says over there, New York City cab. in Baltimore, recognizing risk of sea level rise poses to its historic and other landmarks, the city is developing a preparedness system. The Naval Academy is moving things out of basements and putting it up high. In New York, they're taking the emergency generators out of the basement and putting them up above where the seawater can go. Remember, the big thing that happened in New York was that the hospitals ran out of power. And they couldn't operate the elevators, they couldn't get people out, because all of the emergency power was located in the basement and it flooded. So to say that we are prepared for all of this, I think, is a mistake. We're not. We probably can't respond to all of it except as we are hurt by it. So the level of hurt is going to determine the level of our response. Now, sea level is one that we can see. That's a terrible pun. I didn't think of it that way. Sea level is coming up, and it's having its major effect here on us. And so we can see it. We can feel it. Farmers, other people don't. You would think that the ski industry would be responding vigorously to rising temperatures, because rising temperatures means they have to spend more money to make snow. But it's an interesting thing. That industry has lived with variability its whole existence, and the people in the industry don't pay much attention to it. There's a really terrific book that looks at this part of the whole story from the perspective of skiers. It's written by an excellent skier. His name is Peter Fox. The title of the book is Deep. Now, it has real significance if you're a skier, because skiing in deep powder is just about as close to heaven as any of us ever going to get. And having that to go to now and then, to lose that would be tremendous loss for a few of us, very few, I might say. But it approaches the whole story from the point of view of what's happening at different altitudes, what's happening to the snow, and what does the industry think about it. The only part of the industry that seems to have thought about it really seriously is one group in Aspen. That's because Aspen is about as liberal a place as you will ever get. And politically, I think that's the story there. But the other group of people that thinks about it is bankers. Bankers will no longer give money for support of ski industry in Switzerland and Austria for anything below 1,500 meters. 1,500 meters is quick, Dennis. How many feet? 4,800 feet? Okay. Roughly, as high as Denver. So you got to be a higher altitude than Denver to have any. And that's too bad, because one of the great advantages of skiing in Europe is you can ski at low altitude, but maybe not for long. And he points out that in the book, the estimates are that at very high altitude, like Aspen and some of the big ski areas in the West, there will be snow. And it will maybe the season will shorten a bit, but there will be snow there. But the other part of the story and that Peter Fox goes into is that the character of the snow is changing. The book was started because he lost some close friends in an avalanche. Very experienced people who loved powder skiing and got caught in an avalanche in Washington basically lost their lives. And so he looked into what's happening with snow. And the snow is coming at different times, and it's coming at different temperatures. Avalanches happen when you get enough snow and the snow has changed enough to be like ball bearings. Snow does age, and as it compacts and as it changes into small crystals, round like ball bearings, the risk of avalanches increases. So there are several aspects to it. It makes a great story. If you have any interest in skiing, that's one to look into. I'm going to suggest other books as we go through these lectures, and that's a good one to look at. Finally, I want to leave a little bit of time for questions, and I want to mention that next week's lecture is going to begin with the beginning of the age of humans. What the Anthropocene would be another title for this. And the question is, when does it begin? For most folks, it probably is thought of as beginning somewhere around 1850 or 1750. But there is very good evidence that agriculture started when the carbon dioxide rose very quickly from about 200 parts per million up to 250 parts per million. And the secrets that I'm going to reveal next week have to do with how plants handle carbon dioxide level moving from about 200 parts per million up to about 250 parts per million. What we were studying here was how carbon dioxide would move from about 350 parts per million to about 700 parts per million. And the experiments we did were conducted under those conditions. But a lot of people have been interested in what happens at very low CO2. And very low CO2 was what they had at the end of the last ice age,